Welcome again to a presentation of the Emeriti Hall of Fame produced by the USC Emeriti Center. It's April 5th, 1995. I'm Thomas Green. I teach political science at USC. And my privilege today is to be with Carl Q. Christol, one of USC's most distinguished faculty, recognized by faculty, students, and administrators, and by foreign countries as a pioneering contributor in areas of law, particularly space law, law of international organization, human rights law, and a distinguished teacher at USC for how many years, Carl?
About 40 years, Tom.
What have you learned while you've been here at USC for 40 years?
Well, if I could put that into very few words, I guess it would be that you learn by experience and learn by good associations with faculty members and with students, maturing experience without any question about it.
You've also had a well-balanced life. We've just been talking here about your skiing activities. I know you've been a committed skier ever since I've known you. How has that worked to influence your scholarship?
I think, Tom, the fact is that if the more that you involve yourself in diverse activities, moving from one area of concentration into another area of concentration, giving each area of concentration as much as you can, that you derive a base for doing well, and this has had a good impact, I think, upon my involvement in teaching and research and community service in this community.
So when you're whizzing down the slopes, avoiding trees, you're recharging your teaching batteries.
Not only avoiding trees, but avoiding other skiers. But yes, it's a recharging experience, and something that's very important.
Well, I think of you as having had a very rounded life, complete life, life that's still going strong. You have two articles in preparation now. Do you want to tell us a little bit about what
they say? To go back, Tom, I guess we need to lay a kind of a background for this, but as you were saying at the introduction, I've spent a good bit of time in the field of international law, and a part of that has been international space law. And this was a result of my being appointed for years professorship at the United States Naval War College in Newport, Rhode Island, back in the early 1960s. And at that point, there was a requirement for all of the faculty to do something called the Naval War College Blue Book. It turns out to be kind of a magenta colored thing in the long shot, but something that all of the scholars do there. And so I worked on this for about a year and did this book, which was published, running to about 600 or so pages. And that gave me the inducement, the interest in working beyond that. And so these articles that I'm doing now are simply follow-ups on some of the things which have been developing over the years. One of the articles is something that has received scant attention on the part of international space lawyers, and that has to do with patents and copyrights, because there's a lot of material now that is being broadcast that is copyrightable or patentable, and so I've been working a bit on that. The other article has to do with international space successes, so that you can have the communication satellites actually operating, and one of the problems affecting their success is the presence of debris, space debris. And so I've been working very hard with a number of scholars trying to get a definition of space debris and to bring this to the attention of the United Nations so that they can develop a new treaty on space debris, which is a part of a larger aspect of international space law dealing with liability for damages for those who cause damages to occur.
When you first become interested in this field in the 1960s, there is virtually nothing there, is there? It's a pioneering opportunity.
It was a pioneering opportunity.
And in the midst of a Cold War animosity between East and West.
That was a fascinating part of the research, to see how the Soviets would position themselves at the United Nations and how the Americans would position themselves and how the different sides would seek to get support, the Soviets from their satellites in Eastern Europe and the United States from its friends in the democracies and the rest of the world. And so it was fascinating politics as well as an opportunity to see how law is actually created.
And you had an opportunity to see this at numerous conferences, Malta, Algeria.
Yes, that is true. These various conferences dealt both with the law of the sea and international space law. And that in itself was a very rewarding experience because much of the tradition of the law of the sea was freedom of the high seas, freedom to fish on the high seas, freedom to lay cables on the high seas, freedom of navigation on the high seas. And so the question was, when people put Earth-orbiting satellites into space, were they to be entitled to some of the same guarantees, the same basic laws which had appertained to the law of the sea? And so there was a good bit of borrowing there, and the basic international treaty on the subject going back to 1967 really does pick up on the freedom of the high seas, freedom of outer space analogy.
Law of the sea became an analog for developing a concept of space law.
Yes, indeed it did, yes.
Do you recall some of the personalities that you had to deal with, particularly perhaps from the Soviet Union, who were negotiating and their demands and how eventually some compromise was effected?
Yes. Well, let me give you a couple of names. One is the name of Vladimir Vereshchagin, who was very highly placed in the American equivalent of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Another was an individual named Kolosov, who was a professor at Moscow University. And there were several others, Zhukov being a third. So I got to know a half a dozen or so of the Soviet international space lawyers. One of the areas of compromise which I found fascinating was the effort on the part of the Soviets at the beginning, when they, in effect, modified their position, was that space objects could be launched only by governments. They wished to have, in effect, their economic and social policies applicable to the entire universe. Whereas the United States said, well, no, we are a capitalistic free enterprise system, and therefore we would probably expect to have some governmental launches, and this transpired with NASA, but also to have private opportunities. And so we insisted on private launches. So this was compromised as follows. It was provided in this 1967 space agreement that, yes, private firms could launch, but that the nation state of which the launches were nationals would be responsible internationally for any liability which they created. And so this broke the difficulty, and the Soviets gave in on who should launch. The United States agreed to be ultimately responsible for the behavior of those which were licensed. So that's just one small example of how the another part of the whole thing was that the Soviets had an idea of peaceful coexistence, which you as a professor of political science are well familiar with. And the notion of peaceful coexistence was derived in large part from the language of the United Nations Charter, and it sounded great in terms of the words used, but when you looked at the way the Soviets were trying to implement peaceful coexistence, you could see that they were seeking to advance their own national interests along the way.
How were you able to help in the direction of compromise? Behind the scenes discussions, just getting to know people, or did you have a particular argument that you could advance that you found especially persuasive?
My effort was especially to talk with these Soviet individuals, and particularly at meetings of the International Institute of Space Law. I did not go back to buttonhole and lobby the Soviets at the United Nations late success or in New York City, but did have an impact in my writings and in my personal commentaries, particularly with respect to something called the Common Heritage of Mankind, which came along as a buzzword in which the Soviets were having a hard time to understand. And by the way, you asked me a very broad question at the beginning, and let me develop that a little bit, because there were some personalities outside of the space law field that had a very substantial impact upon my thinking and upon my professional career. And one of those persons was an ambassador from the small island state of Malta named Arvid Pardo.
And, whom I met, yes.
And Arvid, of course, after many years in the political field, came to USC and was a member of our faculty.
Thanks to you, as I recall.
I had a hand in it, I don't mind saying.
And he coins the phrase common heritage of mankind.
He's the one who developed the notion of common heritage of mankind, applicable, to the exploitation and use of the resources of the oceans, particularly deep sea bed and ocean floor. But when it came to the exploitation of moon resources, where the people at the United Nations thought, well, this common heritage of mankind concept was a great one for the exploitation of the moon resources. So it was a controversial thing and still is, but to me it's a wonderful idea because it does call for the sharing of the benefits of exploitative activities with people who are in need in the developing countries. And so I saw a benefit from that. I just would add one other thing, Professor Green, Tom, and that is that in my teaching experience, this has taken many formats, but one format was team teaching. And one of the specifics of that was team teaching, of course, a seminar in international law here at USC with Ambassador Arvid Pardo. And he would take on the issue of the law of the sea, and I would take on the issue of the law of outer space, and I take on the issue of the law of airspace. And between the two of us, we had a glorious time. And between these efforts and the students' input, I think we had a pretty good impact upon the students' learning process and their understanding not only the law, but the politics of the law. Because, you see, Pardo was from Malta. He was from a small developing country. He was one of those who was seeking to achieve whatever benefits he could out of the exploitation of these great resources for the developing countries.
Yeah, we might expect someone from a small country to be interested in a more universal perspective. Mm-hmm. What interests me is how it was that your values persuaded you to identify with this common heritage of mankind perspective, whereas the Soviets, presumably with a more universal perspective ideologically, are given to the pursuit of narrow self-interest. Yes. National self-interest versus
community
universal
interest.
Or community interest.
Yes,
yeah.
Right.
What do you think, Carl, in your background predisposed you toward a community of interest rather than national self-interest?
Well, there are a number of reasons for that, Tom, but one of them that we'll mention right here now is the fact that at USC, in political science, we have had for many years an honors program. And so I was interested at one point in teaching the honors program and was called upon to do so. And for at least 2 years, as I recall, we looked specifically at the problems of developing nations, nation building and the like. And so I got to have a good sense of perspective as to what these new countries were expecting as they became a part of the larger community. Remember, at the end of World War II, when the United Nations was created, there were about 50 countries that worked into the United Nations. Well, today at the United Nations, probably 170 or so member countries. But in the 60s, while the new nation states were a building, were being created out of the old empires, and so it was fascinating to me to see how they would work their way into the world community. Could they be self-sustaining? What would their responses be? And all of that, and that in turn would have an impact upon my international law involvements, but also the specific concerns of these countries.
An important part of your concern also was human rights viewed from an international perspective. I think you innovated some curriculum with regard to human rights, and that again testifies to your universal perspectives.
Tom, that was a...
Was that at the graduate level as well as the undergraduate level?
Let me tell you what the history of human rights has been. Ancient, of course, going back to Adam and Eve, I suppose, human rights. But in terms of becoming a course that was offered in universities and colleges, it turns out that people in law schools got most interested in human rights shortly after the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the various treaties on human rights. And I saw that this was something that was so important that it should also be taught at the college level. So I went on one occasion before the curriculum committee, having received the approval of the political science faculty unanimously, to offer this as an addition to our curriculum. And so we built two courses, one called Human Rights, or rather one called The Politics of Peace, colon, Human Rights, the other called The Politics of Peace, Arms Control and Disarmament. And it seemed to me that these were fitting and congenial concepts at that particular time. This was, of course, in the 60s, as I recall, and the Cold War was still very much alive.
Yes.
And so I'm proud to say that this was approved in the curriculum committee, supported by some of my friends. There was a small issue whether or not this is really something that political science should be doing or whether it's something that international relations should be doing, but that was resolved because I had friends on the committee. And so it was, I'm proud to say that this was the first major university in the United States that began to teach human rights at the college level.
Internationalist interests and orientations, human values, not defined with reference to nation state or culture group, interest in peace, rights defined with reference to individuals in the context of their community. How are these orientations explained given your biographical background? Good, solid American, Midwest, isolationism. We wouldn't expect a Midwesterner to be interested in the law of space, or the law of the sea.
Born on a farm in South Dakota.
We'd expect a law of the prairie orientation.
Yes, but that has to be explained. It turns out that my grandparents were farmers in South Dakota, and my father was German in origin, and he was a professor at the University of South Dakota in the field of European history, and it just so happened that I was with my mother, as might be expected, and was born on this farm. My father, of course, was much interested in the world and had come to the United States when he was 16 years of age, had completed his education at the University of Nebraska, where he had relatives, and went back to Europe, studied at the Sorbonne and at the Heidelberg, and on to the University of Berlin for his PhD degree, and then came back to America and ultimately came to the University of South Dakota. So you can see that his background was a background of varied interests and truly a world perspective. And that's rubbed off on me, Tom, and made me aware of what was going on and turned my attention toward international law. I remember, for example, that in the League of Nations days, there was a great amount of interest in the International Court of Justice and the so-called permanent International Court of Justice in those days. And I remember my father's campaigning in support of the United States participation in the League of Nations and in the permanent Court of International Justice. And these things lingered on and had an impression, of course, as I got into my more formative years and saw the beauties of an academic career and with its challenges, both in terms of research and association with faculty and with students. And so my attention was directed toward that and went on for a PhD degree at the University of Chicago after having studied myself in Europe at the University of Geneva and the Graduate Institute of International Studies in Geneva. And then as my involvement in international affairs continued, I saw the importance of international lawyers per se, and I thought it would be nice to combine teaching the practice of international law. And this in turn led me to law school degree at Yale, and then came out here to California following that and was working with a good Los Angeles downtown blue chip law firm for a year and a half before I came out to USC to take on teaching as a primary function. But during those early years, I also did an awful lot of law work too, believe it or not.
Who was responsible for bringing you to USC? How did that transition take place?
It was one of those things that is quite remarkable that it was not the norm by any means. I was in Los Angeles. I thought it would be nice to remain in Los Angeles. I was with this law firm. And so I then went to USC and to UCLA to see whether or not there were any opportunities that were available. And it turned out that the more immediate opportunity was here at USC. So I accepted it and it was with political science, although I spoke also with the people in international relations here. They didn't have an opening at that particular time. So I really came to the political science faculty as a generalist and did not become the professor of international law until J. Eugene Harley, who was teaching that course, retired, which occurred 5 or 6 years after I came to the campus. And so I was looking forward to that opportunity at the proper time, and it evolved in that direction. I might say also in this connection, it may be of interest to those who have been here at SC for a long time, that I was asked to teach in other departments and schools while I was here. And so I did some team teaching in the School of Social Work with Nora's class, which had to do with the involvement in administrative law and licensing projects, which he was heavily involved in. And then for many years, I did the international law courses, either in international law or in the law of world organizations in the law school. This was on a lectureship basis and was an addition to my normal responsibilities in the political science department.
Your first teaching experience then was at USC after substantial experience as a professional?
Well, let me say that during World War II, I was a teacher. That is to say, if you are a lieutenant or a captain, well, you're expected to do an awful lot of teaching. And so I taught a lot of military subjects to those who were within my command as a platoon leader, as a company commander, as a battalion commander, and so on. I always was a teacher. And then in addition to that, when I returned to the, well, let me say in addition to that, teaching, I had a wonderful experience in teaching at the end of World War II at Biarritz in southern France, courtesy of the United States Army, which had set up an army university there. And then when I returned to New Haven for the last part of my law work, I taught at the community college as a way to gain some income to carry me through. So
in New Haven.
So yeah. I enjoyed it. I liked the people. It was a good experience. I thought I had something to impart. And so it was a good interpersonal relationship, which I've always enjoyed.
I suppose our best leaders are also our best teachers. Yes. Of course, through the PhD program at Chicago and the law program at Yale, you're trained to do research and to be a practicing professional. What did you find as you began teaching in the context of the Army and then thereafter here at USC? What did you find about teaching that made you such a great teacher, one who's been honored by faculty, colleagues, students here at USC as a great teacher? How did you become one?
I think you're talking about somebody else, but in any event, I received some of those awards. I don't know that they're particularly deserved, but I did have an innovative approach.
I think they're deserved, and this is probably when I should refer to my notes. Justin Dart Award for Academic Innovation, University Associates Award for Excellence in Teaching, Raubenheimer Distinguished Faculty Award, Distinguished Emeritus Faculty Award, Student Senate Outstanding Faculty Member Award. If there's an identity problem here, it should have been ironed out at some point. I think they mean you.
Well, I stand corrected.
How come? Tell us.
The record speaks for itself. Okay. No, I was thinking that different approaches for different groups. For example, the basic international law course. That led me to see the importance of interactions between students, and so I created a moot court scenario in which I proposed for their consideration some specific international legal subjects, divided the group so we had two representing one country and two representing the other country, and then they'd have to come before the entire class to make their presentations, at which time I would say, all right, I'm the Chief Justice of the World Court and you're hearing this matter before me, but all the other students in the classroom are members of the World Court, and therefore they're here to interrogate you on the work that you've been propounding and proposing. I thought that was good not only in terms of their getting the research capabilities of going to the sources, the original sources and secondary sources, but also it provided for those students in a small nucleus an opportunity to interact. And I thought that was a positive aspect of the thing. So I felt very good about that. When it came to U.S. constitutional law, here the matter was put forward in case books, and these can be deadly.
Yes.
And as you know, But here the issue was always to try to get the students to become analytical, very heavily analytical.
How do you do that?
Well, you do it by asking them to look at the facts, to look at the issues, to look at the decisions, to look at the reasons, to determine whether or not in your mind, the student's mind, these reasons are good enough to support the positions taken by the members of the tribunal, be they the majority members or the dissenting members or the concurring members. And so this was more of a dialogue situation, which they would be asked to give us a little bit of help at the beginning on the facts and issues, but after that, try to get the students to interact in terms of, well, my idea is that the Supreme Court did very well, or my idea is that the Supreme Court did very poorly here, and this allowed for the visibility of the values which the students held, and they were encouraged to have their opinions.
So, what about the size of the class? As the classes grow larger, do your techniques change? Participation, involvement of the students is more difficult.
Well, that takes me back to the very first year that I was here at USC. There were still a number of students here who had been in the military, and so we had classes in American government that had 400 to 500 students. And I remember getting a lapel microphone and getting in the Boulevard auditorium and standing up there 50 minutes.
That's terrifying.
Trying to keep these students alive and alert. I learned a goodly number of funny stories to interspose along the way to keep them alive, but there was no question and answer. This was strictly a lecture situation.
I think that's important with a large audience. There does have to be an entertainment capability there. Hopefully it's integrated into the subject matter.
So you see, what we're saying basically is that you have a different technique depending upon your audience. You have to know your territory according to the music man.
Meredith Wilson. I'm thinking of the differences, again, in the context of your distinguished teaching record here at USC, the differences between undergraduate and graduate students, seminars, as well as large introductory courses. You've ranged across the whole horizon there.
Yes.
Which were the most satisfying?
It's hard to say, Tom. I think the satisfying experiences were the quality of the students which you found in that particular forum. And not always did I have what I would call superior graduate students. On the other hand, some of them were superior in many respects, but their communicative capabilities were more limited than one might have hoped for. And that was because we had quite a few international students in some of the graduate seminars. Mm-hmm. But over the years, when I learned how to understand them a bit better, I found it highly rewarding because of their own personal experiences. I think of those, for example, from Saudi Arabia or from Vietnam or from Turkey and a variety of countries, Japan and Thailand and the like, who added a great deal to my enjoyment of life, shall I say it that way.
Certainly the USC student body has become more international of origin since you came to USC in 1949. What about changes in quality, motivation, interest, responsiveness to teaching? What have you observed?
That's it's a tough one. I think that in the olden days, when the student body was not so diverse as is at the present time, but still a very large number of foreign students, because Chancellor von Kleinschmidt was a recruiter of foreign students, so we had a very large number of foreign students in those days. We had a good group of students. At the end of World War II, with the GIs coming in, very highly motivated, very fine students, more mature. And then the younger students came along as the GIs moved out. And for a while, the student body was not so diverse. But then it became, again, owing to the population shifts and so on, a more diverse group. In terms of abilities and commitments, I think that the only group that I was not too satisfied with was the graduate student group during the Vietnam conflict. We found a number of students enrolling in the graduate program to get to further their education, undoubtedly, but they sometimes didn't have quite the commitment to the education, and they were frequently part-time. And one of the reasons in my own mind was that they were here in order to escape as much as possible the draft and going to Vietnam. In fact, at that particular time, for many years, I was a faculty advisor for Blackstonians. And so we would have evening dinner meetings, and we'd always have some celebrated lawyer come along or judge come along and give us a talk.
This is a pre-law fraternity?
This is a pre-law, honorary scholastic pre-law society fraternity. And the occasion that turned out, I think, the largest attendance we ever had was a lawyer who was specializing in draft
deferment.
Deferment. And so that was a part of the thing. But the students
well,
have been
speaks to motivation,
very fine,
yes,
Tom.
Yeah,
I have to say the students have been very fine.
It's certainly my observation, too. Yeah, the quality has
You know, you have the good
risen.
Ones and the bad ones and the in-between ones, but you always remember particularly the good ones, although I remember one experience I had in the area of advising, which I referred to. Namely, one day I was sitting in my office, and in come a father and a mother and a young man who was just graduating from high school, and they knew that I was a pre-law advisor, and so they said, well, what can we do with respect to our son? He wants to be a judge. And I said, oh, is that his
He's
career
to the
expectation
right place.
To be a judge? I said, well, there are a few things that he has to do before he becomes a judge, and I gave him a recitation of what I thought was
what
expected.
Happened to that student?
I never saw him again.
Another dropout.
Maybe found a quick appointment somewhere.
Do you recall, without naming names or particular individuals, students that particularly impressed you and that maybe you learned something from?
Yes, of course. There were a number. One, a foreign student whose name is Sufamongkong, who was here from Thailand. I learned a great deal about his country and his commitment to international law. He was one of my PhD dissertation students. I remember Charles Wiggins, who was probably the brightest constitutional law student that I had, and he later became mayor of, what was it, one of the local towns and congressman.
Fresno.
Yeah, and supporter of Nixon during Nixon's hard days, and then also became a United States Court of Appeals justice, which a position he currently occupies. I remember Jim Lloyd, who was a graduate student who came along and working for a master's degree. He was interested. He'd been an aviator in Vietnam and left the Air Force and became a congressman from the Pomona area. I think of Walter Koski, who was a very, very bright young man, went on to law school and now is an associate justice of the California Court of Appeals.
Really?
Bob Lane, who is now university counsel, is a former student who helped both at the undergraduate and the master's degree level. Some federal district court judges and so on, all very bright persons.
What happens when you stop teaching? This, I think, bothers all of us who are committed to teaching. How do you make the transition?
Well, I continue on with a part of the teaching career, that is to say, the writing and research. So I've been doing that which we referred to earlier on.
But do you miss the classroom?
Well, of course. And so one of the things that the Emeriti College has been doing here under the leadership of Paul Hadley has been wonderfully creative and innovative, is to organize speaking opportunities for retired Emeriti faculty. And so he's had a half a dozen or so of these, and I've participated in three or four, giving talks on outer space law and international law generally, but on human rights and on one occasion on environmental matters because I was much concerned with international environmental concerns. So that was a bit of it. And then, Tom, as we said earlier, I did do my law degree and was admitted to practice many, many years ago, about the same time I came to USC. And so I have been doing law work, which is very demanding, time-consuming, and enjoyable, and it certainly keeps you out of trouble.
You haven't slowed down on the slopes or in terms of professional commitment?
No, I've continued on in that direction.
I remember Vince Lombardi, after he'd retired from coaching the Green Bay Packers, saying he missed the fire on Sunday, and I've wondered if after retirement I would miss the fire on Monday and Wednesday. What about other changes in the university, not only in terms of the students, but administrative, professionalism, procedures, the university becoming more of a internationally recognized institution of high quality?
All right. Well, the university...
Who's responsible for this? Name some names. How have they contributed?
Well, I think that you have to look at the faculty and those in administration. In other words, over the years, the faculty have seen the importance of grantsmanship and getting grants, especially those in the natural sciences and the School of Engineering. This brought in very substantial funds. When we had Vice President Caprillion here, he was very much involved in that. He worked very hard and satisfactorily for President Topping. President Topping was a very creative, innovative person. He was really way out in front of everyone else. I mean, he knew what was going to happen the day before it happened.
The Lonely Hearts table at the Faculty Center. Who were involved in that, and what was its contribution to the university?
This was a forum that involved diverse faculty members from different schools, departments, and it was a sought-after experience to get there in time to join the eight or so persons that would involve, in some occasions, Norman Topping, and other occasions, Dean Robert Vivian of the Engineering School, Dean Orrin Evans of the Law School, Totten Anderson of the Political Science Faculty. He and I used to go over there together for that on more than one occasion. People such as Hammond Rolfe and Roger Swearingen from International Relations. People such as Houston Flournoy and John Gerletti and Gilbert Siegel and Robert Biller from Public Administration. From English Department, Errol Arnold, Bill Templeman, Charles Metzger, from Astronomy.
And this was a
John Russell.
Open discussion on problems of the university.
From Geology, Bill Easton.
Life and Times, politics.
Everything under the sun. But it was an opportunity to really share in the ideas of those who were beyond your immediate disciplinary involvement. And it was exciting and rewarding, and it was, as I said earlier, an opportunity to engender some pretty hot discussion and debates. I should also mention Martha Boas used to come to those meetings. She was dean of the School of Social Work, and Joyce King Stoops, who was in the School of Education, used to come. So there were an exciting group of minds there, and we had a good time. Sometimes Russell Caldwell, who was a staunch liberal, would get off on his high horse and be very opinionated, and so we'd very frequently bait him a little bit to see whether or not he could support with something other than eloquence, because he was very eloquent in some of the positions which he advanced.
You were also called on to be an administrator, as well as a teacher and a scholar. You were chairman of the Department of Political Science for 6 years, two terms.
Yes.
Well, did this put a wrinkle in what you wanted to be doing most of the time?
I don't know that I was overly successful as a chairperson of the department. We had some appointments which were forthcoming, and some of them turned out very well.
Were you unable to do the kind of scholarly work that you wanted to do?
During that particular time,
yes,
it was demanding. There's no question about it. It took time away from
sacrifice.
Scholarly work. But one of the things which...
Did you learn things about people you never suspected?
one thing what we did do when I was chairperson was to work up a departmental constitution, which I think, from my perspective, I can't speak for others, from my perspective, it had a positive effect. Because here we got organized in such a fashion that we could take a more systematic view toward the research and writing involvements of the members of the faculty, what their teaching capabilities were, what their community services to the university were through committee activities and the like. At least we had some sort of a format that we could use as a kind of a guide. It wasn't set in concrete, obviously, but it was something that was very helpful. And by the way, that reminds me, Tom, that you and I had a good experience together, and that you and I were co-authors of a basic book in the field of political science.
Yes, well, that was with Jim Anderson and earlier Carlton Rodee.
Yes.
That was my good fortune to be brought in on that.
Well, we did four editions of that, and it was, I thought, a very good experience. In fact, I got to know you better, and I got to know Carlton better. Of course, Jim and I had much in common because, believe it or not, his father, my father, had been friends at the University of Nebraska.
Really?
And so when I got out here, one of the first things my dad said to do was to go out and meet Mrs. Anderson, the widow, and to meet Jim, so I did. So I knew him before I became his colleague at the University of Southern California.
Do you look at your royalty statements on that McGraw-Hill text to see how many copies are being sold in Singapore?
I can't believe it. By far
the largest user.
I can't believe it. These checks.
Someone in Singapore
in.
Is very well informed. Department chair and distinguished faculty and teacher and internationalist in terms of conferences, publications. This has been just a perfect mix, I think, also given your interest in outdoor activities and the quality of your family life.
Well, it was a versatile...
You might be our ideal type.
It was a fairly versatile experience, and I'm glad you mentioned the family life, because during all this period, I had the great support of my dear wife, Jenny Jeanette, and she accompanied me on many of the different undertakings which came my way. And in this connection, I must say that I owe a great deal to Ross Burkus, because he, as the director of the School of International Relations, was able to arrange some teaching opportunities because the IR had programs in England and in Germany. And so on two occasions we taught in England, and Jenny went with me on that occasion, on those occasions. And then there were the opportunities for our daughter Susan to come and visit us when we were in England. In fact, you know, the first time that we were there, she was in school at a place called High Wycombe, which was outside of Beaconsfield, which is a famous old town, and did a good bit of studying there. And then following that particular semester in England, we had a sabbatical and went on over to Geneva, where I had been a student, as we pointed out earlier on. And this provided an opportunity for our daughter Susan to go to a school called Pré Fleuri, which was up in the mountains near Zermatt, Crans Montana, for those who know that area. And so she had a good experience there as a student learning French and learning also how to ski. And during that time, Jenny became involved with the World Peace Through Law Group in Geneva, because they were having one of their annual meetings there. And so she organized the lawyers' wives for that particular conference and had a good experience along that line. So generally speaking, we had a very fine combined effort along many of these academic professional lines.
There has to be the family support. I suppose we're best remembered by what we've published, for better or worse. And writing is such a lonely task. Yes. And it's important that the wife and the children understand that Dad's got to be left alone.
Yeah. Well, it's true that if you're going to do anything effective in the area of writing, you have to have 4 or 5 hours that you're completely free of any other responsibilities in order to get into it. In my case, I find that I could work very well in the evening, and so after the family had gone to bed and had other things to do, I'd get into my study and get things together and could work until 11, 12 o'clock at night without any problem, getting up in the morning without any problem.
Of the books you've written, was there one that seemed to write itself, that you were just exhilarated whenever you finished a writing session, or didn't that ever happen? Was it always a struggle, as it is for most of us?
Some of them are more struggles than others. But one that I had to rewrite, one chapter I remember I had to rewrite a number of times because it was a very difficult topic. It had to do with science and technology. It had to do with broadcasting. It had to do with who has what wavelengths and what is a right to, in any event. This was something I wrote and rewrote happily, this was done in Lake Como in Italy. I had a good grant one summer from the Rockefeller Foundation, went on over there, and they gave me a typewriter and some paper, and I took along a suitcase full of materials, and I was exhilarated, I guess, when I finished that particular chapter under such pleasant occasion.
Yes, Northern Italy is a good place to be exhilarated. Mm-hmm. Is there a book that you would most like to be remembered by as a scholar?
Well, I like some of those chapters in Introduction to Political Science very, very much. The one that I did on law and the legal process, I think, is a very fine chapter in that particular book. And so I'm really quite proud of that.
Much of your scholarship might be defined in terms of the essential role of law in ordering human relationships, and without law, there's not much chance of justice. Law has been your focus. Does law get in the way of politics, or does politics get in the way of law? You've observed politics on campus and in the real world. You mentioned Houston, Florida, earlier. What's the relationship there as you've observed it over time, law and politics?
Well, they are certainly interrelated, and there's the old story that I expect everyone has heard about law and the formation of laws and statutes and sausages. You remember the comment on that, namely, if you would see how sausages are made, you wouldn't like to eat sausage. Well, if you see how laws are made, you don't like laws either. And this is where the politics comes in, and the pushing and the shoving and the lobbying and the compromising and the... But I must say that in my own experience, I found it quite easy to be committed to my principles, but at the same time, being committed to principles, being able to modify some of the ways of achieving those principles so you're not locked into a no-win situation by being so committed to principles you don't get anything at all.
No law, no civilized society.
Absolutely.
You've made an important contribution in civilizing all of us.
Well, you see, we're interested in the legal process, Tom, and the legal process is a democratic process insofar as you are in a democratic society. And so here you have the give and take of the positions of the people as reflected in their representatives, although I must say that some representatives, as you and I well know, get so locked into their own privileges and prerogatives that they sometimes feel it's more important that they retain their seat in the House of Representatives and Congress than to save the country. You may, again, remember the old statement of the fact, what does it profit a congressman if in the process of losing in the process of saving the country, he loses his seat in the Congress, you see. So that's a kind of a cynical thing, but nonetheless, it's real. And so there is some argument in favor of retiring some of these old fogies that stay in the Congress too long.
Term limits.
Well, it's a debatable subject, obviously. And it takes some experience to learn how to run things, and you hate to give up all that experience and turn it over to the bureaucrats.
Carl Christol, thank you for coming to USC.
Thank you very much, Tom Green, for being one of those I've known so well and favorably these many years.
My privilege.
Yeah.